This morning I want to talk about the Bible. Usually we talk from the Bible, and we're going to do that also, but this morning we're also going to talk about the Bible. Specifically, is the Bible true? Or is it simply a book of myths and stories and other collections of writings from men? The Bible's getting a bad name nowadays in a lot of different ways. The culture is working hard to basically undermine the Bible and discredit the Bible. And so I think it's well worth for anybody that is either searching for truth in this life, or has recently come to faith and wants to make sure that they're on a solid foundation, or even those of us that have been walking with the Lord a long time. There's many things that we can continue to be encouraged about as far as the Word of God, the power that it has, and the place that it has in our world today. In John 18:38, Jesus, our Lord and Savior, is brought before Pontius Pilate, and he's being questioned as to why the leaders of that day find him guilty of something. And Pontius Pilate's the Roman ruler, and Pontius says, "So you're a king then?" And Jesus says, "You're right in saying that I'm a king. In fact, for this reason I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone on the side of truth listens to me." And Pilate says, "What is truth?" And with this he went out again to the Jews and said, "I can't find any basis of guilt in this man, you know, and he's going to wash his hands of the whole situation," is what he says. But he asked that question, what is truth? Even 2,000 years ago, a Roman ruler of a whole area of Judea there, he's asking the question, what is truth? And we're going to take a look at that this morning, truth. This is truth, my friends. This is real truth right here. And I'm not asking you to just believe that because I'm saying it. We're going to go take a look at some things, you know, some proofs, if you will. We're going to be like a little bit of a Bible CSI this morning, and we're going to go and investigate some things about the Bible. Solomon, King Solomon, the wisest man that ever lives, he wrote the book of Proverbs in the Bible, and he wrote the book of Ecclesiastes. In Proverbs 23, he says, "Buy the truth and don't sell it." He's very much emphasizing about each and every one of us needs to search for and find the truth, and when you do, hang on to it with all you've got. Don't let it out of your grasp. The truth, and don't laugh, but the Oxford University Press, a legitimate university study organization, they published an encyclopedia identifying 10,000 different religions in the world. 10,000. So when we search for truth, we've got our hands full. 10,000 religions, that doesn't even include all of the subsects and denominations within those religions, you know. So, you know, we listen to King Solomon, who says, buy the truth, but what are we supposed to buy? Who are we supposed to believe? You know, is there really only one God, you know? And has he really only revealed himself to us in this one book right here? Well, for 4,000 years ago, the prophet Job, in this book, he says, "Where can wisdom be found? And where is the place of understanding? Man does not know its value. It can't be purchased for gold, nor can silver be weighed for its price. The price of wisdom is above rubies." So are we to stumble through life uncertain about where to actually find truth, or can we truly know the wisdom and truth from the one true God as it's found in the Bible? I want us to kind of this morning look through what we're going to be looking at through the filter of an outsider, you know, someone who's not a believer, perhaps, the outside world looking in at the Bible, you know. Well, the first thing is we have this book right here. It's called the Bible. We call it a book. But it actually, the word Bible comes from the Greek word biblia, which actually means a collection of books or a library. This is actually not one book, but it is a collection of 66 different books, all, you know, compiled and kept together there. For 2,000 years after creation, God spoke to men like Abraham and Noah and Adam in the first place verbally. He just spoke to them verbally for 2,000 years. Starting after 2,000 years, he began to take certain men and have them sit down. He chose them, and what has been revealed to us in the Bible is through the power of the Holy Spirit, these men sat down and they documented the thoughts of God and the historical accounts of what had gone before. All right? So God used about 40 men over more than 15 centuries. This book is actually not written in one sit-down or even over the course of a year. This book is a compilation of 66 different books written by about 40 men over a period of about 15 years, spanning from Moses in about 1500 BC to about 100 AD when the prophet John, the apostle John, actually dies on the island of Patmos after he writes the last book in here, the book of Revelation. 1500 year span, 40 authors, 66 books. The terms are used to describe this, such as the Holy Scriptures, the writings of the prophets, the Word of God. The Torah, the Psalms, and Gospels refer to specific sections within the Bible. Even in Arabic, these scriptures are called Al-Kitab al-Muqaddas, meaning the Holy Book. And that's significant. I want you to remember that, because we're going to take a look later on at what other religions, how other religions even come and confirm the Word of God itself through their own writings. Well, century after century, this book has been on the bestseller list forever. There have been more copies of this book published and bought and sold throughout the world since it's been put together. Amazing thing, an amazing history that this book has for staying together like that. To date, the Bible has been translated into more than 2,400 different languages. And another almost 2,000 are currently in progress. There are certain missionary groups in the world today that they've made it their mission, such as Wycliffe Bible Translators and others, to get the Bible translated into every single dialect and tongue that's out there, because they firmly believe that the great commission of the Lord is going to require us to take the Word of God to every single people, tongue, tribe, and nation throughout the world, places where they don't even have a written language. You know, they're starting to use electronic devices, recorders, where they actually verbally record the Bible in their language, and they can take these things and they crank them up. They got a little generator inside them, or they're solar powered, so that they can listen to the Word of God. But that's the pervasive nature and power of this Word of God, how widespread it is going throughout the world. But it wouldn't surprise you if I told you that in spite of all that, the Word of God is under immense persecution right now. In fact, there are Christian countries throughout the world today where you're not allowed to read the Bible in school. You're not allowed to quote Scripture in school. You're not allowed to do things like that. Tremendous pressure. The Bible is under assault, you know. To give you a little brief glimpse of what's going on, we have to take a look at the present day culture and some factors that are at play here and why the Bible is coming under so much assault. Three factors. The first one is this steady rise of skepticism within our society. You know, we're beginning to elevate man and his intelligence and his thinking over everything else. We're beginning to worship science and rationalism. That seems to be the order of the day today, even if it turns out to be faulty science and junk science. But we lift up science to a much higher position than we do the Word of God. And so society is out there telling you that, don't ask me to really believe, you know, in some collection of ancient stories, poems, sermons, prophecies, and letters written over 1,500 years by some old men, you know, and that somehow you put it all this together and you're calling this the sacred Word of God. You know, come on, give me a break about this, you know. But if you recall that the percentage of Americans who believe in the Bible is on the percentage of Americans who believe that the Bible is just another book written by men is definitely on the increase right now. You know? So we have to watch out for that. So too, the perception that the Bible is actually harmful and that people who live by its principles are religious extremists. That's out there in the culture right now. If you follow the Bible, you're some kind of nut. Second thing is that the broader culture has adopted self-fulfillment as its ultimate measure of moral goal. Society out there today doesn't want to believe in one simple and single moral standard, one absolute truth for right and wrong and behavior today. They don't want to do that. We've adopted an attitude of, if it feels good to me, or if I feel like it should be this way, then that's the way it should be. You know, I can't be wrong. My feelings can't be wrong. I think something's unfair. I think something's wrong. You know, it must be right. And we're looking inside of ourselves for truth. We're looking inside of ourselves for fulfillment rather than the external source, looking to our Creator God who made us and the revelation that He has given us about Himself and why we're here. And the last thing is the explosive growth of digital tools out there. I mean, I wouldn't be off to say that pretty much everybody here probably has a cell phone in their pocket, you know. Well, you can get data access cell phones anymore. You can get more information than you'll ever need in your lifetime. But with the free and easy availability of all this information comes all kinds of contradicting views now, you know. Anybody that has any kind of wild idea about something can go post it on the internet, and you start looking something up and there it is. Oh, this guy says the Bible's not true. This guy says there's all kinds of contradictions in the Bible. This thing, you know, so on. So these three factors are working very hard and in collusion in order to bring the Bible under attack, because make no mistake about it, the purpose for all of that is to undermine this book and undermine the Christian faith and undermine Jesus Christ and take away the value of anything, you know, from Him and of the Bible, and take away the one single place that mankind can go to find true forgiveness for their sins, which is the cross at Calvary. But thankfully, there's still glimmers of hope. I mean, you know, God's not dead. He's surely alive. He's living on the inside, and He's roaring like a lion. And He is, you know. And we can take hope in certain aspects of that. They have done some surveys recently. There's a group called the Barna Organization, and they do all kinds of surveys and on the Christian, on Christians, Christian beliefs, the Bible out there. And I think some very encouraging statistics. One of them is that most Americans, including a majority of young adults, do believe that the Bible has been more influential on humanity than any other text. So to this day, most people still believe that the Bible has had quite an influence out there. They're just starting to modify the effect that it has had on the world. They're coming back to now say, yeah, it's had an effect, but it's been a bad effect. A majority, also including young adults, believes that the Bible contains everything a person needs to know in order to live a meaningful life. Everything you need to know to live a meaningful life. And I'm going to come back to that in just a minute. Two-thirds of all Americans hold an orthodox view of the Bible. That is, that it's the actual or inspired Word of God. Two-thirds of Americans. That's pretty good. Almost 70% of Americans still believe that this is the inspired Word of God. Nearly half of Americans read the Scriptures at least once a month. Faithfulness to the Bible is strong among practicing Christians of all ages. And as American culture becomes more post-Christian, that is, as the population moves away from Christian beliefs and practices, there is some evidence that interest in the Bible may actually be on the rise. And it should be, as we are continually bombarded with literally millions of contrasting views. I mean, how can we not be confused? And I believe that God is using that confusion to drive more and more people in a search for the truth. Where before they didn't think about it, now you can't help but think about it. It's hitting you smack in the face, you know? What are you going to do with this? What are you going to do with this text? Yet the world continues to take on mottos like everything is relative, or it's wrong to think that a person can know absolute truth. Well, you know, one doesn't have to be a PhD in logic to recognize that there's a contradiction in those kind of statements. Because if there's no absolute truth, how can you hold a view that makes an assertion that everything or anything is wrong in the first place? There's no absolute truth. Then how can you absolutely state that this is wrong, right? So they've got their own contradictions to deal with right now. And of course, you know, that great verse, John 8:32 says, "To all who seek Him with an honest heart," to all who seek Him with an honest heart, Jesus says, "You shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free." I want to come back for a minute just to that statistic about a majority of Americans believe the Bible contains everything a person needs to know in order to live a meaningful life. You have to start with a list of eternal questions that all of us probably have to deal with. You know, who am I as a person? How did I get here? Is there a right way to believe and to act? Is there a God? And if so, what does He expect from me? Is there life after death? How do I achieve eternal life, if it even exists? Will I someday be held accountable for the way I lived on earth? What is the meaning of life and death? Seriously, profound questions here. Would it surprise you to know that the Bible is the single authoritative, you know, all-inclusive text that answers every single one of those questions? There is no other system of belief out there in the world that even begins to tackle even a portion of these questions. You know, there are some that might have one or two, but not all of them. Where do we come from? We have the other than to believe in some kind of a, you know, cosmic evolutionary system, the story of Adam and Eve and how we were created by God coming down and breathing life into the dust of the earth, it doesn't occur anywhere else in anybody else's belief system. Christianity is unique in that regard. And I want us to know that and to be encouraged by that and be strong in that. When people come to you about this book, you know, where else are you going to go for answers? There are no other answers anywhere else. They'll talk to you about they're a religion. They'll come to you with rules on how to live and things that may help you out in the short term kind of a thing. But really to answer, you know, the cosmic questions of how did I get here and why am I here and where am I going and what do I got to do to get there? No way. You know, all those questions, who am I as a person? Psalm 139. How did I get here? Genesis 1:27. Is there a right way to believe and to act? Deuteronomy 6. Is there a God? And if so, what does he expect of me? Matthew 22. I'm just shooting these out. I can copy these. I don't think I put these in your sermon notes, and I apologize. I probably should have. Are they in there? I didn't. But anyway, is there a God? And if so, what does he expect of me? Matthew 22. Is there life after death? John 11 and Luke 23. How do I achieve eternal life if it exists? 1 Timothy chapter 1. Will I someday be held accountable for the way I live on earth? Revelations 20. White throne of judgment right there for everybody to read about and see. What is the meaning of life and death? Romans 8, 22, 23. Meaning in life comes only by answering all these eternal questions that I've mentioned to you, and they're only adequately addressed in the Bible, in the single revelation from the one true living God, our Creator God, who's sent all this to us. There is real power in this book. Real power in the words on this book. Power that you would not find anywhere else. All right. In Jeremiah 23:29, the prophet the Lord says in speaking to Jeremiah, "Is not my word like fire, declares the Lord, and like a hammer that breaks a rock or hardened hearts into pieces?" Isaiah 55, verses 10 and 11, "As the rain and the snow come down from heaven and do not return to it without watering the earth and making it bud and flourish, so it is with my God, so it is with my word, the Bible, that goes out from my mouth. It will not return to me empty, but will accomplish what I desire and achieve the purpose for which I send it." God promises in his word that his word has power. Okay, it's able to penetrate hardened hearts, he says in Jeremiah. And he also says in the King James Version, says, my word shall never return void. In other words, whenever the word of God is broadcast out there, like we're doing this morning, we're preaching and it's going out on the internet, I mean, or you just reading your Bible, God says that his word never comes back empty. Okay? It's like the water, the rain's coming down from earth and going into the ground and being absorbed and coming back up, you know, and producing something, causing something to grow. He compares his word to that. And you know what's interesting? I think I might have put that note in there in your notes. But if any of us remember our grade school science classes, we learned the evaporation cycle. Remember that? The clouds, and it comes down the ocean and the water and the rivers and then the plants and then the evaporation, it goes back up. Well, here it is, 750 years before Jesus Christ was born, okay, so almost 3,000 years ago, in the Bible, this book of fairy tales supposedly, there's this description of a scientific evaporation cycle just casually thrown in there. You know? So can I believe the Bible? Can I trust the Bible? Absolutely you can, and I'm going to tell you this, test it. Test the Bible. The Bible will withstand any kind of rigorous testing if you really come at it honestly and pragmatically. In other words, without any preconceived notions about what to find or not to find, test the Bible and you will never be disappointed. You can test the Bible archaeologically and factually, historically. You can verify the manuscript evidence. I mean, how did this book get to me here in 2016 from all these guys that wrote this stuff 2,000 and 3,000 years ago? You know? The Bible is self-explanatory. It explains itself. The Bible has worked its way into so many aspects of our lives today. I use the word pervasive. That's what it means. It means it's all-encompassing. It's spread out there. You find evidence of the Bible and corroboration of the Bible in all kinds of things that we're not even aware of anymore in our society. You know. And lastly, that there is power in the Word of God. Anybody that comes honestly seeking and reads the Word of God will come away changed. You will come away feeling that power and feeling the presence of the Lord in that. So let's take a quick look at these things archaeologically, historically, chronologically, facts that can be proven, all right? Every name, place, date, or historical occurrence can be verified that is mentioned in this book right here. It can be verified through other corroborating sources for history's sake, all right? I opened with Pontius Pilate. Well, Pontius Pilate was indeed the Roman governor of Judea and Palestine in 33 AD. That's a historical fact supported by other historical documents outside of the Bible. He was a real man. A famous physicist by the name of Franckby, Dr. Franckby, he said, "Where there is sufficient documentary and archaeological evidence to make an investigation, the original statements of the Bible in the original text have stood the test every time, every single time." And another prominent archaeologist, he examined the book of Luke, just examined the book of Luke, and he found that it referred to 32 countries, 54 cities, 9 islands, without a single mistake, in just one book in the Bible, book of Luke. All right? The archaeological confirmation based on the archaeological evidence is overwhelming. There's a passage in John chapter 5 where Jesus heals a paralytic in the Garden of Bethesda, or Bethsaida, all right? And in that passage, it refers to the Bethsaida pool having 5 porticos. 5 porticos are like covered archways that have columns on them. And for years, people said, "Ah, look, see, we know where Bethsaida is here in archaeologically, and we can't find any porticos or any pool or any 5-sided pool that it mentions there. So the Bible must be wrong. You see, this must have been a passage written by someone else many years later that didn't really have that good of a grasp of the terrain of the time and what the city was laid out to look like. And they just kind of made it up. It helps make the story believable, but it's not true." Well, no, actually, in the 19th century, up until the 19th century, there was no evidence outside of John's gospel for the existence of this pool. So scholars had argued that the gospel must have been written later, all right? However, in the 19th century, archaeologists discovered the remains of a pool fitting the description in John's gospel. It turned out to be actually 2 pools, 2 rectangular pools with a wall in the middle. And they were saying, "Well, how can I have a 5-sided pool?" Well, because it was up against the cliff and a rectangle coming out, and then it had a wall in the middle. So I had 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 walls on this thing. Aha! That's when they actually started digging. They actually found that. Then they found all the porticos and the colonnades. As recently as 1964, they did final excavations there, and they laid out this whole thing that they didn't realize was there, and it came to what? Validate the description in the Bible, not undermine it at all. The archaeological evidence will always prove the Bible, not disprove it. You want another one? How about the city of Jericho? City of Jericho, destroyed 1400 years BC by Joshua. Some of you may know the story that when Joshua was leading the Israelites out of the desert into the promised land, God told them they had to take the city of Jericho. And he says, "But I want you to take it my way, not your way." And he had them march around the city for 7 days once, and then on the 7th day they marched around it 7 times, shouted their trumpets. The Bible says in the story that the walls fell down, and then the Israelites came in and burned the place to the ground. Well, for years, they couldn't find the city of Jericho. You know, they thought this whole thing was made up. But, again, archaeological digs over the last 200 years started going in there, and they found a place, a pile of rubble that matched kind of the location of where in the Bible it had described where Jericho would be, so many miles outside of Jerusalem. They started digging. Lo and behold, they find this evidence of these big rampart walls, and lo and behold, the walls showed that they fell outward. usually when you take a city, I mean, they try to bust into the city, you know, and the archaeological evidence shows that there's breaches in the wall and the breaches are inward. In this case, all the walls fell outward. Everything in there showed evidence of being burned. And using pottery fragments that they found there, they were able to trace, they're able to date this back to 1400 BC, exactly the time of Joshua. All right. And what's significant to me is that in verse 26, Joshua is told by God that that God will curse anybody who ever goes to, attempts to rebuild anything on that site. And for 2400 years, no one did ever build anything on that site. Not at all. Why not? You know, it can't be explained. But there it is. City of Jericho and its archaeological evidence pointing to that. How about manuscript evidence? The next thing is manuscript evidence. People say, well, you know, how can this book, I mean, it's been copied over and over again. Somebody must have made a mistake on this book, right? Would you believe that when the scribes were copying these parchments, basically, I mean, we're talking about, when we talk about a manuscript, we're talking about a handwritten copy of this. First of all, the Old Testament written in Hebrew, they only used consonants. They didn't use vowels. But they had the ancient scribes, they had scribes that were responsible for counting out the exact number of lines on each page, the exact number of consonants on each line, the exact number of words in each line. And over again, from the manuscript evidence that we have relating to the Bible, it shows an absolute accuracy that cannot be explained any other way. There are, you know, some say it's the best preserved book in history, you know. For the New Testament, there are over 24,000 ancient manuscripts, including 5,300 in the original Greek, and 230 of those are dating to before the 6th century. These manuscripts establish the New Testament as the best documented text in history. You know, we talk about Roman history, Egyptian history, Greek history, the Greek philosophers. We have 1/100th the number of copies of the works of Aristotle and Plato and these Greek philosophers than we do of the Bible, and yet nobody questions whether the works of Aristotle ever happened or not. You know, and when you compare the writings between, let's say, these 230 manuscripts that you have of the writings of Aristotle, they vary widely in the number of words and what they're actually saying. I mean, the meaning is still there, but they vary widely. 230 copies. The Bible, the New Testament, 24,000 copies, and every single one of them accurate, except for some minor typographical or a word omission or something, but when you check the context of everything, they always fall completely back in line. You say, yeah, but how do I know that it was been preserved, you know, all those years? Again, when man's faith fails, God always sends him something. And in 1947, there was an amazing archaeological discovery near the Dead Sea. The Dead Sea Scrolls were discovered in a place called Kirbet Qumran, right adjacent to the Dead Sea, 1947. A Bedouin shepherd boy in search of a lost goat stumbles upon a cave with clay jars that contain many ancient scrolls in Hebrew, Aramaic, and Greek. Between 1947 and 1956, more than 225 biblical manuscripts were found in those 11 caves, and scholars dated these scrolls to having been penned between 250 BC and 68 AD. The oldest ones they found were almost 100 years before Christ came, all right? And they began, and this was an opportunity for the world. They said, aha, see, we're gonna get a chance here to disprove the Bible. We finally found some copies of the Bible that are older by 1,000 years than what we have so far, so let's see exactly, you know, how little those copies measure up. Would it surprise you to find that God is faithful to His Word? And they were able to compare these scrolls from 1,000 years prior, and every single one was absolutely accurate to what they had up until that date so far, barring, again, some minor typos and a word omission here and there, but everything was exactly the same. There is no explanation for that. There are no other documents in existence in this world written by men that have ever been proven to maintain that kind of accuracy over that kind of time period. And I say that to make a point. You know, we're not here just living a life that's based on fairy tale books. This is the real Word of God, the real revelation from Father God, our Creator, to you and me, to all of us as His creation. He speaks to us through this. He explains to us how we got here, why we're here, what He expects us to do, how much He loves us, how He knows that we're going to fail. And in spite of us failing, that He's got an answer for that. He's going to send His Son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross for us. The manuscript evidence is overwhelming. I mean, you could take a whole day and just examine all that if you're interested online, the amount of manuscript evidence that's out there. It's too, not to, you know, go on a sidetrack here for the message this morning, but just it's another point in confirming how God protects His Word and why we're not, you know, fairy tale believers to believe in the Bible. We're rational thinking people that have explored this, you know, and you can find real proof in why I should believe this book. Another great thing about the Bible is what the Bible actually says about itself. You know, the Bible is the only book where the author is more acquainted with the reader than the reader is with the author. Think about that, you know. Who wrote this book, the God who wrote this book, knows us better than we know Him. That's why He wrote this book, all right? In Deuteronomy 8, this is what He writes. Man does not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of the Lord. Why do I start with that verse? Because we used that verse last week too. That was the verse that Jesus used in His defense when He was being tempted by the devil after His 40-day fast. You know, and what was His weapon against the enemy? The Word of God, because there's power in this Word of God. He says, "Man, I don't live on bread alone. Don't tempt me with food and drink. You know, I live on the Word of God. The Word of God will sustain me." 2 Timothy 3, all Scripture is God-breathed and useful for teaching, directing, rebuking, correcting, all those things. The Word of God can be used to teach, but it's God-breathed. When we have these 40 different authors, they all wrote these texts under the power of the Holy Spirit. This isn't just Moses sitting down, and I think I'll write a fairy tale about how the world began, you know. He's being told by God to pen this down. 2 Samuel 22, the word of the Lord is flawless. It is flawless, folks. We're going to look at that in just a minute, because one of the objections that the world has is that the Bible's been corrupted and it's full of contradictions and all that kind of thing. But no, it's not. The Word of God is flawless. First of all, He says so Himself. Psalm 129, the Word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. I'm walking around in the dark about something, consult the Word. Consult the Word. Go to the Word of God. Pray about it. Go to the Bible. Open it up. Start reading it. I don't care where. You know, the Bible is that powerful and that supernatural ability that the Lord has. You're struggling with something, pray about it. Go to the Bible. Start reading. You're going to find peace about whatever it is you're dealing with. Matthew 24. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will never pass away. God is actually confirming that His Word is so powerful that it is eternal. It is eternal. It always has been and it always will be. His truth is forever. It's not going to pass away. Ephesians 6, take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. When we're told in the Bible to put on the armor of God to protect ourselves and to be able to defend the faith against the world, well, there it is, the Word of God, which is the sword of the Spirit. The sword of the Spirit, able to be used as an offensive weapon and as a defensive weapon. People come at you about something, you can use the Word of God, just like Jesus did. Use the Word of God. And Jesus Himself, He's called the Word. Jesus is referred to as the Word in the Bible. Why? Because He is God's ultimate best form of communication between God and us. Jesus says that. You want to know the Father? Know me. You'll know the Father if you just know me. I am the representation. I am the story. I am the letter from. I am the Word from God. You know me, you're going to know the Father. John 1, famous verses. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. If you change that, in the beginning was Jesus, and Jesus was with God, and Jesus was God. He was with God in the beginning. There's no doubt about that. Jesus is God. And John, again, the same chapter, verse 14, the Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. The ultimate form of communication between God and man took on a human body form and came to spend time with us to help us to understand our Father God Creator, the Word of God. Another argument in favor of the Bible is that there's no other book whose sphere of influence is matched, you know, outside of the theological area as much as the Bible is, okay? Bible sayings in everyday life. I'm going to just, if you guys want, have a little fun here with some Bible sayings. You think about it, how much the Bible has weaved its way into our culture, into the world, into sayings, and some of us might not even know where they come from. Have you ever, you've heard of the expression, I'm going to wash my hands of that matter. I wash my hands of that matter, right? Well, we just talked about, that's from John 28, Pontius Pilate, that's where he said that. He goes, you know what, it's a way of absolving myself of guilt on something. I'm going to wash my hands of that matter. Matthew 27, John 28. How about talking about someone and you say, he's the salt of the earth. That guy's the salt of the earth. Huh? Comes from Matthew 5, 13. You know, we are to be the salt and the light, you know. How about when someone says, oh man, you know, you can't change that. It's written in stone. It's cast in stone. It's written in stone. Referring to the Ten Commandments, all right, that were given down to Moses. I mean, Moses wrote one set. Little Bible trivia here. How many sets of the Ten Commandments were actually made? There were two. There were two, I said, you know. First one, God wrote out with his finger on the tablets, and Moses came down from the mountain, and he was so upset that the people, within the short time that he was up there on the mountain communing with God, they had turned to partying and, you know, melted gold down, made a golden calf, started worshiping an idol. He got so mad, he threw the tablets down and broke them. So now he's got to go back up to God and say, I need another set. And God, you know, he didn't say it like this, but God made Moses carve out the next set. He said, you know what? You carve them out again. So two sets, but carved in stone, cast in stone. That's where we get that expression from. You know, it means infallible when something is cast in stone. How about turn the other cheek? Heard that expression? Turn the other cheek. Right? Comes from, we know Jesus says, you know, if someone strikes you on the right cheek, give them your left cheek also. You know? In other words, you know, be humble and take it. You reap what you sow. You reap what you sow. Galatians 6. We will reap what we sow. God will not be mocked, and we will reap what we sow. Doubting Thomas. We've heard when someone doesn't believe what we're saying, we might refer to them as a doubting Thomas. Well, that's one of the disciples, Thomas, who wasn't there the first time Jesus in his resurrected form came back and presented himself to some of the apostles. So he said, he doubted. He says, I'm not going to believe unless I can see the holes in his hands and put my finger in the holes and touch his side and make sure that it's the legitimate Savior that was crucified on that cross. And of course, God, Jesus grants him that desire and does exactly that, and he comes to faith, you know. A couple more. He saw the light. You know, somebody was just lost and doing something wrong, and then all of a sudden he saw the light, he saw the error of his ways. Well, that's from the Apostle Paul, or Saul beforehand, his Damascus Road experience. This man was persecuting Christians in the first century. Felt he was a Pharisee of Pharisees, had a great zeal for the Old Testament portion of the Bible, and didn't understand that God was making a new revelation. You know, and he was persecuting these people. He thought they were heretics, that they were destroying his religion, basically. And he had a zeal for killing them. And at some point, God just came down out of heaven and in a bright light and showed himself to him and changed his heart. You know, I always love that story because I always like to be able to point out the conclusion that, you know, anyone who ever has a face-to-face experience with Jesus Christ will not go away changed. You understand that? Anybody, all of us here, you ever come face-to-face with the Lord, I guarantee it, you will be changed. And I don't mean it's going to be a flash of light on your way out of here. Hopefully not, because we might be driving a car or bicycle or something. But, you know, if you, at some point, we meet in our spirit face-to-face with Jesus Christ, He will change you. He will change us. He has changed me. It's better to give than to receive. Right? Jesus said that in Acts 20. Better to give than to receive. Let he who is without sin cast the first stone. All these things like that. That one comes from John 8. All these Bible sayings in our everyday culture. How about just our dating system? What year is it? 2016. 2016 AD stands for the Latin Anno Domino, which means in the year of our Lord, in the Lord's year. The whole world pretty much dates, keeps track of dates now because of the Bible dating system. Before that, we said BC, 3,000 years BC, before Christ. The Bible is pervasive in everyday society. And lastly, again, there's power in the Word of God. As I read earlier, Jeremiah 23 says, "Is not my word like fire, and like a hammer that breaks a rock into pieces?" And Hebrews 4 says, "The word of God is living and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even to dividing soul and spirit." The Bible, the word of God can cut into anything, in other words, cut into any situation and divide it up properly and fold it apart and help you to see the things the way they really are. It's that much of an authority. It is that accurate. And there's real application for everyday living. Real application for everyday living in these ancient texts, if you want to refer to them as that. Okay, the Bible contains real truth for every single situation in life that you're going to encounter today, even. They refer to it sometimes as the Living Bible, and that's why, because it never ages. Its truths are timeless. Its direction is timeless. It contains something in there, like I said earlier, for every single situation and challenge that you may be facing. You struggling with something, pray about it, open the Word. My sister-in-law, she's down visiting us for the weekend. She's in the process of transferring from Tennessee down here to Tampa for her job. And she got saved about 12 years ago, coming to one of our church services at my home church on a Wednesday night. She was struggling with a lot of things, and the pastor, you know, spoke about the truths of God and how much God loves us, and he gave an invitation. My sister-in-law got saved. But she's been living a life kind of, you know, kind of a Romans 7 life like we talked about last week, you know. The good I want to do, I don't do, and the evil that I don't want to do, I still do. But she's hanging in there. She's doing her best. And she's been dating a guy. She's divorced and she's dating a guy, and she's been struggling with, do I move down here, and what do I do with this boyfriend kind of a thing. And out of the blue, she thought, you know, there were some things that were bothering her about this relationship. And so she stunned my wife and I. She says, I prayed about it, and then I went on the internet and I punched and I described the way he was acting, and I said, what does this mean? You know, what does this mean when a guy does this, you know? And she said the first thing that popped up on her search engine was Proverbs 23:6. You know, because she had this thing, I'm not going to get into details, but she cooked a dinner, and he was being very selfish about something with food and relating to her kids and how he was treating her kids and some food situation. And she said it just floored her. There it was, Proverbs 23:6, do not eat the food of a stingy man. Do not crave his delicacies, for he is the kind of man who is always thinking about the cost. Eat and drink, he says to you, but his heart is not with you. And she thought, wow, is that of God or what? She prayed about it some more, and she decided that, you know what, it wasn't the right relationship for her, and she maintained her commitment to come move down here. And since then, I'm sorry to say, maybe I'm happy to say that the man showed his true colors, and it was wisdom of God that she did not pursue that relationship anymore. And she's telling us the story about, it was a God thing, right? I mean, I haven't been reading my Bible, and I went to the internet, And on the internet, God used his word to give her direction specifically, intimately, into the situation that she was dealing with. You know, and my wife goes on now and Googles the same thing. It doesn't come up. It doesn't come up for my wife because it wasn't meant for my wife. You know, that's the power of the Word of God, and that's how intimate our Lord God is. How he wants to be involved in all aspects of your life like that. So in spite of all this overwhelming evidence we just talked about, archaeological and manuscript and, you know, pervasive nature of the Word of God in our society, in spite of all that, there's still a lot of people that absolutely refuse to believe the Bible. They do. And they've got some, what they feel are some pretty solid objections. Just want to take a quick look at some of these objections. The first one that always comes, that you're going to hear about, is, oh, the Bible, it's based on myths. It's a book of myths, you know. In our secularized, Western, modern world, European descendant world, you know, many people declare that the Bible is nothing more than a collection of stirring stories and beautiful sayings, but in the end, invented by men. Invented by men. And most the thing is, most of the people that hold that opinion, they hold that opinion without ever having investigated the Bible on their own. Does anybody know who Sir Arthur Conan Doyle is? Who is he? He's a writer. What did he write? Sherlock Holmes. Sherlock Holmes, right? He wrote the fictional classic, the celebrated Cases of Sherlock Holmes. Well, Sherlock Holmes states in one of these, he was supposed to be this master of deduction, right? Well, he makes this statement in one of the books, it's a capital mistake to theorize before one has data. Insensibly, one begins to twist facts to suit theories instead of theories to suit facts. And that's what we encounter in the real world most of the time when people are going to throw something up at the Bible, some kind of objection about the Bible. You know, they're making that capital mistake and they're trying to, you know, take their theory to suit the facts instead of the other way around. A second objection that a lot of people has is they make that statement that the Bible is full of contradictions. Well, I'm here to lay that claim as false. The Bible does not contradict itself at all. It may make statements that seemingly on the surface contradict one another, but the Bible never, when you perform a full examination of it, does it produce any kind of real contradiction. Because people will say things like, well, wait a minute, you know, I mean, I'm reading the Bible and it's so full of these contradictions, how do you expect me to take that book seriously? I mean, I read in Genesis 1, starting with verse 3, that on the first day, God created light and then separated the light from darkness. But then I read in the same chapter, 10 verses later, in verse 14, that the sun, which separates night and day, wasn't created until the fourth day. How can that be? Bible saying light on the first day, sun on the fourth day. It must be some kind of contradiction. Again, in Genesis 2, it says that Adam was to die the very day that he ate of that forbidden fruit. And three chapters later, in Genesis 5, it says Adam lived to be 930 years old. Some kind of contradiction there. You're supposed to eat the fruit and die, right? And one more. In the book of John, chapters 3, 8, 12, and so forth, it says that Jesus doesn't judge. But then in other chapters of John, and in the book of Acts, and even later on in Corinthians, it says Jesus does judge. Must be some kind of contradiction. Well, take a look at that. First of all, we don't have to check our brain at the door when we study these kind of contradictions. You know, God actually, in his word, encourages us to come and reason, okay? He says in Isaiah chapter 1, verse 18, come now and let us reason together, okay? God wants us to be skeptical. He welcomes our questions. But come into his word with an open mind, praying about it ahead of time to be led by the Holy Spirit. God will reveal to you what the real truth is in there, you know? Proverbs 14 15 says, the simple believes every word, but the prudent one considers well his steps. So there's encouragement for us. We're allowed to take a look at these contradictions, you know. But do your own honest research. Don't rely on what someone else said, and certainly don't take anybody's opinion without having gone to the Bible yourself and read it in its full context, read some comparing verses to see what it says, because the Bible tends to explain itself. The Bible tends to explain itself. You may hear the expression sometime, compare Scripture with Scripture. Don't compare it with something else. Compare Scripture with Scripture. The Bible will validate itself. But you have to taste it for yourself, you know. Anybody like to eat mangoes? I love mangoes. Delicious, you know. What if you were asked to try to describe the taste of a mango to somebody by writing it down, or even just saying it? Like, what does a mango taste like to you? In the end, you cannot fully describe it to them. In the end, they have to taste it for themselves to really, truly experience what I feel is a pleasure of a mango, right? Well, Psalm 34 says, "Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Taste and see that the Lord is good." In 2 Timothy chapter 2, the Bible says that we're to be ones who do not need to be ashamed and who correctly handle the word of truth. We don't need to be ashamed when we correctly handle the word of truth. There's a children's ministry that's been very popular for many years. It's called Awana's, A-W-A-N-A. And it stands for Approved Workers Are Never Ashamed. And their motto, Bible verse, is this, 2 Timothy 2:15. You know, you do not have to be ashamed when you correctly handle the Word of God. So, just pay attention to the context in which it is, correctly handle it, and you'll be fine. I mean, to illustrate that, I gave you those three seeming contradictions, and I wasn't going to just leave them out there without showing you what, you know, explaining those away. Okay? When it talks about not being judging and that Jesus judged, all right? The Bible, on the one hand, tells me as a creature limited in knowledge not to judge or condemn another person's motives or actions from a self-righteous, fault-finding perspective. I am not to judge another person, where they're coming from, what they're going through. Okay? But on the other hand, I am commanded to judge or discern right from wrong and to differentiate truth from error based on what the Scripture says. I'm not to judge you, but I am allowed to make judgments, certainly as they pertain to myself, about what is right and what is wrong. So a seemingly on the surface contradiction that the Bible is saying judge and then it says don't judge, no, it's easily explained away. Same thing with the references to Adam. You know, God said if you eat of that fruit, you're going to die. Well, a lot of people don't know, but in the beginning when God created Adam and Eve, He created them to live forever. He created them to live forever. And there was no death in the Garden of Eden. Okay? And there weren't even thunderstorms, some people say, because in Genesis it talks about all of the plants were watered by the springs that watered up out of the ground and took care of everything. It was this beautiful, ideal setting. Okay? But when they ate of that forbidden fruit, they disobeyed God, and there was a consequence for disobeying God. And from that day forth, their bodies began to age, and they were going to die. The Bible is still faithful and true, and they did die. And in fact, the Spirit of God in them died, and it can only be replaced by the Spirit of Christ later on. But they did suffer a death, a spiritual death, and their bodies began to age. Now, when you say that someone's going to do something that's going to kill them, just because it doesn't kill them for 930 years doesn't mean that statement wasn't true in the first place. You see that too. But they did die. They weren't meant to live forever, and yet they died. And as far as the contradiction about the light in Genesis 1, you know, well, the light is the power of God. That was there before God even created the sun, you know. And people can understand that too quite easily. All of these contradictions, if you have an open mind, you're willing to sit down and go through them, you know, especially if you pray about them and ask the Holy Spirit to guide you, they can all be explained away. This book has great power, contains great truth. Just a couple more and then we're done. People say, I don't believe in the New Testament. You know, I believe the Old Testament, ancient manuscripts, okay, fine, you know, Moses wrote some stuff, I get that, but this whole New Testament thing with Jesus and all that, I don't believe that, you know. But as I mentioned earlier, first of all, our dating system is based on the life of Jesus, you know. The manuscript evidence says that Jesus, when he was resurrected, showed himself to over 500 people. 500 people. I mean, in today's rules of evidence in the court system, that would be way more than enough to prove that he was alive again after he died. You know? The Bible is divided up into two parts. Some of you may know this, the Old Testament and the New Testament. All right, the Old Covenant and the New Covenant, the Old Promise and the New Promise, that's what they are. They're not the same thing rehashed. They're the Old Testament history of God revealing himself to a particular chosen people at the time, the Israelites, and making all these promises in the Old Testament that are foretold about what's going to happen in the future. And all these writings, they end about 400 years before Christ came. 400 years before Christ came. And for 400 years, there's nothing. And then Jesus comes on the scene and he's born. You know, and then after his death, they all begin to write about it. And for the next about 100 years or so, they're writing all these things, again, under the power of the Holy Spirit, documenting what happened. You know, there are no contradictions between the Old Testament and the New Testament. The Old Testament prophesies hundreds of prophecies about Jesus Christ and his coming. And they say that the odds of all of those prophecies coming true in one particular person are so astronomically high as to be impossible, and yet they all came true. You know, he was of the lineage of David. He was born in Bethlehem. You know, he died on a cross. None of his bones got broken when he died. All these things, I mean, there's hundreds of them, prophecies from the Old Testament about the coming of Jesus Christ. They all turn out to be true. The New Testament is called the gospel. We call them the gospels. It contains the gospels, which means the good news. It's about the good news of Jesus Christ and his coming. It's written down by no fewer than 8 men during the first century AD. And the New Testament records all of Jesus' initial coming to earth, and it provides a lot of commentary on the Old Testament scriptures and foretells how the world history is going to conclude. The New Testament is actually for us now looking ahead as well. We can look behind and see what happened, what Christ did for us, but we can look ahead to the future. Christ says he's coming again. That's a wonderful news. Christ is coming back. He's coming back for you and you and you, all of you and me. You know, all of us that call him our Lord and our Savior. He says, I promise you, where I'm going, I'm preparing a place for you, he says. When I come back, I'm going to come specifically for you. That's a great promise of hope to live on, to hang our heads on. There's a saying that says the New Testament is in the Old Testament concealed, and the Old Testament is in the New Testament revealed. And that describes this situation perfectly, is that the Old Testament, in all of its prophecies, is predicting what's going to happen coming in the New Testament. And in the New Testament, it's all of the fulfilling of what was called for in the Old Testament. Yeah. Remember, Jesus says in Matthew 5:17, don't think that I came to destroy the law or the prophets. In other words, the Old Testament. I didn't come to destroy, but I came to fulfill. The New Testament is the fulfillment of the new promise. The new promise. The old promise was that I'm your God, and I've created you, and I love you, and I've given you some rules to live by, not because I'm a power-hungry God, and I want to restrain your life and contain you and control you, and I'm some kind of a control freak, but because I love you so much, and you don't realize it, but these things are bad for you. And as a loving parent to my creation here, I'm giving you these guidelines that if you stay away from these things, it will go better with you in your life. But I know you're going to slip up, so when you do, you've got to come to the temple, you've got to bring a sacrifice, you've got to, you know, repent of your sins, you've got to do all these things in a way to help restore the relationship with me. Old Testament, old promise, old covenant, old way of sin forgiveness. New Testament fulfillment, at some point, I'm going to send the ultimate sacrifice for your sins, Jesus Christ, the perfect Lamb of God, sinless man, God in the flesh, going to come down. He's going to teach you about me, about himself, confirm his power, and then I'm going to let him be taken prisoner and put up on a cross and nailed there and tortured, and he's going to be put to death, and that's going to pay the penalty for the sins of mankind once and for all and forever. And all we have to do is look at that cross and believe. That's all we have to do is believe. Believe that God loves me so much that he would do such a thing. I mean, a man wouldn't do that for someone else. Maybe a parent might do it for his kid, but you know, for you or me to sacrifice ourselves for people we don't even know, No way. That's supernatural. That's the love of God personified there, of Jesus Christ hanging on the cross. You know? And it's so simple, friends. Don't make it any more complicated than it is. All we have to do is believe on the Lord Jesus Christ to be saved. When I'm struggling with my life and I'm wondering, you know, I've been living in my own will and my own way, and just things have just been spiraling more and more out of control, and I just can't seem to get a leg up. Look to the cross and believe. Believe that God loves you, that God has a plan for you, that He paid the penalty for your sins and you are forgiven. You just have to come to Him and receive that free gift. God is holding out that free gift all the time for all of us. That is the message of the Bible. One God, one message. The message is that we are loved so much by an eternal God. He created us. He has a plan for us in this life. We decided we didn't like His plan, decided to do our own thing and do our own plan. So I ask all of us here in a moment of true honesty, how has our plan ever worked out in our lives? I know mine failed miserably, 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 miserably. You know, I have to give up my will and my way. I just have to surrender. Just like when we're praising and worshiping, some of us hold up our hands like that. It's like an act of surrender. I'm saying, I give up. I give up, God, not my will, but your will. Take my life. Please, do with it as you will. That's it, just an act of surrender. You know, as we talked about last week, it doesn't mean that from this point on I'm never going to sin again. And you know, no, it just means that I know that I do wrong and I can never get right with God on my own. But Jesus Christ did it. He is the connection between me and God. And I just have to say yes to that man on the cross, that God man on the cross. Just say yes to that, friends. And you can know that from that point on, your sins will always be forgiven, past, present, and future. Jesus says that the ones that the Father gives me in my hand, they can never be snatched away. That one moment when you come to that realization of who we are and our sinful nature, you know, relative to a perfect and holy God, and we say, I'm sorry, I can't do it on my own, Lord, but I accept what Jesus did for me. That's it. That's all it takes. There's nothing else. You don't even have to know anything about this book just yet, except that maybe you know that what I'm telling you is in this book, but that's it. You just have to know that between you and a sinful God, we're not right. We're never right. From the moment we're born, we're not right. But we can get right very, very quickly. Just say yes to God. Just say yes to God. I'm going to close in prayer and give you an opportunity to just turn your life over to Jesus Christ. He's a loving parent. He's given us this wonderful revelation, His Word. There's power in this book. Read it when you get a chance. Ask God to reveal things to you. But before you even do that, if you don't know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, believe in Him right now. Let's pray. Father God, we love You and we thank You for Your Word, this revelation teaching us everything we need to know about You and how we got here, why we're here, what You want us to do while we're here, and whether there's a right way and a wrong way to live, and what I have to do to be with You forever in heaven, Lord. Thank You for telling us all that, laying it out so clearly in Your Bible, Your Word, Your revelation to us, Lord. Thank You. My prayer now goes out to anybody here, Lord, that has never come to a saving faith in You. They've never come to that point in their lives where they've just surrendered their will and their way and turned their hearts over to You and just said that I believe in Jesus and what He did on the cross. And if that's you, friend, right now, then just in the quiet place of your heart, just say this right now. Very simple prayer. It's not the words that are going to save you in any way. It's just you coming to this position before God and just saying, God, I know that I've made a lot of mistakes. I know that I'm a sinner. But I believe that You sent Your Son Jesus to die on the cross to pay for all of my sins. And right here and right now, I believe and I trust in Jesus for the forgiveness of my sins based on His sacrifice on that cross. And then, Lord Jesus, I invite You to come into my heart, come into my life, and from this point forth, start to lead me and guide me and direct me and show me how to live for You and pull me up out of the messes that I made for myself in my life, Lord. Pull me up and direct me in a new way. In Jesus' mighty and precious name, I pray these things. Amen. Amen. Friends, if that was you this morning, I mean, we love to celebrate anybody coming to faith. I'm not going to put you on the spot or embarrass you, but we like to know because we are an evangelical mission here, and we love to celebrate new people coming to faith. And if you don't have a Bible, I want to give you one. If you don't have one, and But if, would you do me a favor, and if for the first time here, just only for the first time, if you're praying that prayer and saying, I believe in Jesus Christ for the first time, would you put your hand up and just put it right back down? Anybody, thank you for that. Anybody, anybody, come into faith. Thank you, thank you. Luke 15 says there is more celebration in heaven over one lost sheep that comes back into the fold than over 99 that don't need to be saved. It's an amazing truth, again, from the Bible. The Bible is truth, friends. I hope I didn't go on too much in an academic fashion. Sometimes I tend to do that. I'm an engineer by trade, and so I get into the details. But I love this stuff. I mean, there's the point is, if you come away with nothing else this morning, is that when you inspect the Bible and you examine the truth of the Bible, the foundation of the Bible, you will never be disappointed. It's always going to come through. It stands on its own. Don't let anybody bully you into believing that this book is not true and that it doesn't come from where we say it comes from. Don't let them do that. The culture wants you to do that, and the arguments are weak. We love you. We thank you. And let's bow our heads again, because we invite you all to stick around, and we're going to have a great meal planned for you. And we're going to pass out the offering collection plate for Pastor Lionel's church. This all goes to Pastor Lionel's church. If have a couple of men that could, or somebody that could pass this out. I'm going to close. Thank you, Daniel. I'm going to close this in prayer again, and we'll say a blessing over the food. Father God, thank you for your wonderful hand of provision on us individually and on this mission and collectively. Thank you for all the food that comes and goes out of this mission. Thank you for all of the solid preaching and teaching and your word that comes and goes out throughout this mission, Lord. And as we just saw again this morning, you promised that your word will never come back empty. It will always bear fruit, and we stand on that promise. But thank you for the physical food that we're about to eat right now. We ask that you bless it to our bodies and our bodies to your service, to bring you praise and honor and glory, and keep us in our comings and goings safely as we leave this property either right now or later on after we've done eating, Lord. Just watch over us. And God, I ask for just an extra measure of your presence and comfort for everybody in this room today as we go forth. In Jesus' mighty and precious name, amen. Amen. Amen.